Hey folks, I'm over at Boulder Bookstore again, signing books. It is December 10th?
December 10th!
It is December 9th, 2021, and I have signed, I don't know, a couple hundred of the Poetic Edda, the Saga of the Volsungs, the Wanderer's Hobmall, and my latest book, Two Sagas of Mythical Heroes. If you want to get one for someone by Christmas, I would say go ahead and order right now in the next couple of days. I'm not going to be able to do any more personalizations in 2021, but there's enough stored up that if you just want a signed one, I think you can definitely get one for anyone you want for Christmas or New Year's. And I'll be back here throughout 2022, I presume, signing more and more of these and doing more personalizations. So the opportunity will still be there, but you're running out of time for Christmas. All right. For now, all the best. Hi, I'm Old Norse Specialist Jackson Crawford, and in this installment on my Patreon-supported YouTube channel about Norse language and myth, I want to look at the myth of Loki being punished. There's a lot of details to the story, but one of the central ones is that he's tied up with the guts of one of his own sons. The details of this punishment occur in two different places, in the prose of the Prose Edda, and in the prose, I'll come back to this in a minute, of the Poetic Edda. And the reasons for the punishment are different in each place, as well as some of the details. And then we have hints at some of the details elsewhere. So there's some kind of core story here that has developed differently in a couple different places, or at least been presented by different storytellers for different reasons. It's hard to say exactly what the track is, but I want to look at where the story comes up, what those differences are, and what we can maybe infer about this myth or other myths in the Eddas from that data. If you don't know the difference between the Prose Edda and the Poetic Edda, let me recommend that you watch a video that I made about that subject a few years ago, as I think it might clear it up for you. All right, well, let's proceed with the question of the myth of Loki's punishment. So I mentioned that the details of the story occur in both the prose of the Prose Edda and the prose of the Poetic Edda. What I mean by the prose of the Poetic Edda is that the poems collected in the Poetic Edda, Völuspá, Hávamál, Lokasenna, are however old. We don't have to get into that question right this moment. But the prose, prologues, and epilogues to them aren't necessarily anywhere near as old as the poems. So when we find a poem like Lokasenna, for example, which in its entirety as a poem starts with Loki showing up at a feast of the gods and starting to insult everyone, and then ends with him leaving, we also have this prose prologue that says he's come back to the feast that he was kicked out of after killing someone, and then it has an epilogue that says, and then he was punished by being tied up with the guts of his son, etc. Those aren't part of the poem itself, and so might not originally have actually been connected to that story. You could read the poem of Lokasenna from the first to the last stanza without that information, and it doesn't necessarily add anything to your understanding of what's going on in the poem. So, just because the editor, right, whoever put together the Codex Regius manuscript or the manuscript that it was copied from that was written about 70 years earlier, just because that person attached the story of Loki being punished by being tied up with the guts of his son to the story of him insulting the gods doesn't mean it originally had anything to do with that story. All right. So what does the prose epilogue there say? En eftir þetta falsk Loki í frónangers forsi í lax líki. Þar tóku æsir hann. Hann var bundin með þormum sonar síns nara. En Narvi sonar hans var þett vargi. Skadi tók eitrorm og kvesti upp yfir andlit Loka. Draup þar or eitr. Sigin kona Loka satt þar og held munlaug under eitrit. En er munlaugin var full bar hon ut eitrit. En meðan draup eitrit á Loka. Though kip this can swo heart with thadan av skalv och jorth all. That eru nu kaladir landskjóttar. And after this, the events of the poem, Loki hid himself in Franangr's waterfall in the shape of a salmon. The gods took him there. He was bound with the guts of his son Nari, and his son Narvi turned into a wolf. Skadi took a poisonous snake and fastened it up over Loki's face, and poison dropped out of it. Sigyn, Loki's wife, sat there and held a big basin under the poison. But when the basin was full, she carried the poison out, and meanwhile, the poison would drop on Loki. Then Loki would jerk so hard in reaction that from the jerking, the entire earth shook. That is now called earthquakes. All right, so here we have some central, pretty well-known details. The poisonous snake that drips its venom on his face, his wife Sigyn, whose only mythical role is in the story, catching the poison and pouring it out when the basin she's catching it in fills up, and him causing earthquakes when the poison does hit his face because she's out emptying the basin. Now Snorri tells a very similar story in very similar words, but according to his account, it is not insulting the gods and Lokasenna that he's being punished for, but rather the death of Baldur that he's being punished for. Let me give you a quick word from my sponsor in the usual fashion. I'll come back and read that bit from the prose edda and then look at some of the questions this raises and some other data. So Snorri says, after the killing of Baldur, Nú var Loki tekin gríðalaus og farit með hann í helinokvon. Þó tóku þeir þjór hellur og settu á egg og lustu ráv og helun í hverri. Þó voru teknir sinir Loka, Voli og Nari eða Narvi, brugðu esir Vola í vargslíki og reif hann í sundar Narva bróður sinn. Þó tóku æsir þarma hans og búndu Loka með yfir þó þrjó steina. Ein undir hernum, annar undir lendum, þriði undir knesfótum og urðu þá bond að jörni. Þó tók Skadi eitrorm og festi upp yfir hans og að eitrit skildi drjúpa úr orminum í andlit honum. En Sigyn kona hans stendur hjá honum og heldur mundlaugu undir eitrdropa. En þó fúlar munnlaugin þó gengur hon og slær út eitrunu, en meðan drupir eitrit í andlit honum. Þó kipisk hann svo hart við það jörð ól skilfur. Það kallið þeir landskjólta. Þar liggur hann í bondum til Ragnarökkurs. Now Loki was taken without mercy, and he was taken into a certain cave. And then the gods took three flat stones, Hellur. This is the same as in the name Helluland for some part of Canada, according to the sagas of exploration of North America, the Vinland sagas. It took three flat stones and set them on edge and punched a hole in each stone. Then the sons of Loki were taken, Voli and Nari, or Narvi, and the Aesir gods turned Voli into the shape of a wolf, and he tore apart Narvi, his brother. Then the Aesir took his intestines, Narvi's intestines, and bound Loki with them over the three stones, one under his shoulders, another under his groin area, a third under his knees, and those ropes, his intestines, turned into iron. Then Skadi took a poisonous snake and fastened it up over him so that the poison would drip out of the snake into his face. Sigyn, his wife, stands next to him and holds the basin under the poison drops. But when the basin is full, she goes and throws out the poison, but meanwhile, the poison drops into his face. Then he jerks so hard in reaction that the entire earth shakes. And y'all call that earthquakes. This is, Har, Jafnhar, Thridi talking to the narrator of Gylfaginning, so the Jarl is humankind. And there he lies in his bonds until Ragnarok. So some interesting differences and some interesting similarities. For one thing, there's some details in Snorri's account that aren't told in the Poetic Edda account and that I feel like don't show up very often in people's images of the scene, particularly the three flat stones that have holes punched through them in order to bind Loki to them with guts. It's interesting that in Lokasenna, when Skadi threatens Loki with being bound up with the guts of his son, she says bound to a sword, which you could take as maybe poetic, alternation for a rock somehow, but maybe the poet is thinking of a sharp edge, like the sharp edges of these flat rocks. It's also interesting that in both versions, it's Skadi who does it, Skadi who takes care of putting the poison snake up there. Why is that? Is Skadi particularly offended by the death of Baldur? It doesn't seem that likely, but although she did want to marry him before she married Njörður. But in Lokasenna, we have a more natural explanation for why it's Skadi, because she actually starts telling him, you're going to be bound to a sword with the cold guts of your son. We notice that the names of the sons are somewhat different. We have Nari and Narvi in the account and the prose after Lokasenna, but we have Nvoli and then a single son who's called Nari or Narvi in the prose Edda account by Snorri. Now, in the poetry of the Poetic Edda, we have what seem to be references to the story, but not in any detail. In Völuspá, in the Codex Regius manuscript version, stanza 34, we read, following the account of the death of Baldur, Haft sohon ligja under huera lundi lagjarn liki, loka oathekjan, thar sitter sigun, thuigi sin ver vel gluyuth, vituth erin eða huat. She, the vulva, Ceres, who's seeing the vision in Völuspá, she saw lying under a grove of hot springs. Hard to know exactly what to do with this, or perhaps we can take this as under a certain grove. One with a body of the lie yearning. That's taking lag yarn as lag yarns with a missing S genitive singular ending, as most people do. None other than Loki. There Sigyn sits, though she is not well gladdened by her husband. Do you know yet, or what? So, this proposes only that Loki is bound somewhere. We know this anyway from a lot of vague references to there being a bound Loki, and that Sigyn is next to him, but we don't get any of the details about the snake and the poison and the sun turning into a wolf and all that stuff. But interestingly, in the stanza of the Hauksbok version of Völuspá, in stanza 30, we do get maybe a connection to that. It's hard to know. We read there, Thóknó vola, vígbón snúa, heldur voru hardgór hóft or þormum. Þar sittur sigin, þögi sin verver glúð, fytu þærin eða hvat. So what's strange here is the grammar suggests either that vola would have to be nominative, and then that's some woman with the name Vola that we don't hear about anywhere else. And then we would see that then Voli twisted the bonds. Or someone else is twisting them, then unstated person twists the bonds, the chains of Voli, because this would be the possessive form, the genitive singular form of the name Voli. The bonds, the chains, were made rather hard out of guts. That suggests that what's being referred to here is, in fact, the story of the guts of Voli being the ones that bind Loki. But it is in neither the Lokasenna prose version or the prose Edda version that it is Voli's guts that tie up Loki. So there's some other variant going on here. And then we get the same last part. There's Sid Sigyn, though she's not well gladdened in her husband. Do you know yet, or what? It's been a long day. So we cannot say for certain what the original details here are. One of the strangest being who are the sons of Loki who were involved, and which one is which? Which one is turned into a wolf, and which one, and thus kills the other one? And then who is that other one who has his guts turned into the chains that hold Loki down? Why is Loki held down? Why is it Sigyn who sits there? That may seem like kind of a dumb question because, well, that's what she does. She's his wife. But we don't hear about her elsewhere, right? His famous children are with other beings. Angerboda is the mother of his three really famous kids, Fenrir, the Midgard serpent, and Helm. Why do we have this other completely peripheral woman in his life otherwise showing up right here? You know, there may be some other story about Sigyn and Loki that's just missing to us today. Why is it Skadi who ends up tying up the snake that drips poison into Loki's face? Before you say she's a goddess of poison, the reason people say that on the internet is because she puts the snake that drops poison into Loki's face above Loki. You know, nowhere in our actual Norse sources are there labels like goddess of poison or anything like that. And goddess of poison seems like a really limited role for anyone. So there's some kind of core story here, and I don't know which original story leads up to the punishment. The Lokasenna frame, where he's insulted the gods, seems to kind of make sense in that we have Skadi telling him this is going to happen. But it's interesting that there she does say sword. So possibly that poem was originally preserved in a context where it was a sword he was tied to specifically, something that doesn't mention the details of Snorri or elsewhere. But then Völuspá situating the story of the bound Loki right after Baldur's death, and then Snorri also situating this as the punishment for Baldur's death, makes some sense. Though we have to note that the story of Völi, interesting that there's that name again, although for a different person. The story of Völi avenging Baldur's death on Hother appears to be much older, as the details are more consistent and attested in more archaic places, right? Like Völuspá. Völuspá gives us quite a few details about this. Baldur's Drama refers to it. As I recall, Völuspá's Skáldmar Hinnlo even refers to it. So I'm often irritated to be accused when I talk about Loki being punished for insulting the gods in Lokasenna by being, you know, tied up with a snake dripping poison on his face. When people say, hey, no, that's actually his punishment for killing Baldur. Well, it depends on which source you read. And I'm more of a Poetic Edda guy, but I have to admit that it's not the poems of the Poetic Edda that tell us that this is why he was punished this way. It's prose, which could come from as late as 1270, when the copy of the Poetic Edda manuscript, the Codex Regius, that we have comes from. So I'm not sure, but I just want you to have this information and know what the different versions are, and know that, as always in Norse myth, it seems like the answer is it's kind of complicated. For now, beautiful Colorado, thank you, Patreon, for your continued kindness and support, and to everyone out there, all the best.